I'm really the last speaker because I'm the least sexy of the lot here. I've been a banker for more than 20 years, and then we've been going on doing our own business for the last 20 years, and then somehow for the last 3 years we woke up and we found ourselves that a lot of the people are kind of getting into our space, into our business. And you know, there's one part to all the gifting, the games, the wearables, the buying and selling online, is at the end of the day, it's still moving money. So I hope that the banks will remain relevant for years to come, because that's where your money still sits. We have been doing banking 1.0 for the last 20 years, and like I said, we woke up one day and we are fast forward to banking 3.0. We didn't really quite get a chance to go to banking 2.0. Brad King says that banking 3.0 really means that banking is what you do and no longer where you go. So that's kind of heartbreaking for bankers like us. And I've worked in many markets across Europe, Asia, and Middle East. We spent a lot of money into building our branches. And now some people are saying we don't need to go to your branches to actually undertake financial transactions. So even for the banking world now, this is a huge, it's a huge evolutionary process for us, if not revolutionary. As you know, bankers, traditional bankers in particular, we are the dinosaurs. If you were to talk to the digital age people, we do things very differently. And therefore, there's a huge drive towards digital in the banking world. And what we're experiencing is what we call marketplace disruption. Fabulously, Alibaba is one of those great marketplace disruptors. Not just on the payment side, but Alibaba takes money as well now. So we're saying that we're no longer just the people who take deposits from customers and manage your money. You have non-banks now that actually also manage money or take money from other people. So in our world, we call non-banks marketplace disruptors. And therefore, there's a lot of competition. It's not just among banks. And you know, after the last Western financial crisis, the whole financial markets is going through a process of change in itself. That, with regulatory changes, together with increased competition from non-banks, is a completely different new world for us coming through. And then what we've come to realize is that banking products are generally homogeneous. And in this new age, you really have to differentiate yourself. And so again, it's a different world for us. Marketing has taken a completely different new meaning for the financial world. The marketplace disruptors, Facebook coming in and say they're going to do their own payment. And in the UK, there's a bunch of people who said that we're going to launch a new bank, absolutely digital, no branches required, which means they're not going to have to take on the cost of setting up a bank. Traditionally, you know, the traditional cost of capital for a bank is huge. And you have the likes of BBVA, which is actually a Spanish bank that recently bought Simple in the US. Simple is a digital bank. And the reason for a traditional bank to buy a digital bank is because this traditional bank, which is headquartered in Mexico, discovered that if I buy this digital bank in the US, overnight I have access to 100,000 American customers, which I otherwise would not have. And Simple cost $14 million to set up. $14 million. My bank has a capital of over $2 billion for a bank to run, and they took $14 million to set up a bank. And then you know, Vodafone, mobile companies are doing the same. What's good is, I'm glad to say that my peers, at least, are coming back with the ventures, and so you do see evolvers in the market. So you have National Australian Bank, NAB, and Commerce Bank in Germany, setting up wholly owned subsidiaries, which are standalone digital banks. So you will see in the market moving forth, these traditional banks have taken a view that, look, we also have to move, we have to evolve, And maybe from the parent bank, it's not quite possible to move as quickly because of the core banking system and the branches that we have. So some banks have taken the route by setting up standalone digital branches. And so we're seeing that in some markets, as I say, NAB, Commerce Bank, and a few coming on board soon. And why is everybody in our space? We keep saying. I was just telling my fellow panelists, I was at another banking conference a few months ago, and everybody was getting nervous about the whole digital space and that how all these non-bank players coming into our space. And the reason is because of a lot of money to be made. At the end of the day, the three speakers before me were talking about goods that you would buy and sell, that all involves payment, and there's huge money to be made in this payment space, and that's why everybody's jumping into the bandwagon. Malaysia is a very small country in ASEAN, relatively well-run, but nowhere near as big as China. I think we're as big as Chengdu. But with our 30 million population, we do have huge internet penetration and 100% mobile penetration. And of that, we're talking almost half of smartphone users. And so for a country like Malaysia, there is a lot of governmental efforts to actually push the growth of mobile and online. And we're seeing that the growth of mobile is actually outpacing online in Malaysia. And our central bank has actually come out with a ruling and said that by next January, we're going to increase check price, and we're going to expect to see a reduction in the issuance of checks. So what it does is that it has pushed banks to actually look at alternatives within the digital solutions to provide for our customers, right? So it is changing, game-changing, not just for us, but it's also game-changing for consumers that are being pushed to actually change and evolve. And electronic payments is actually in part of the Malaysian blueprint, and therefore there's a huge push by the government towards this. And we estimate that 79% of the Malaysian population by 2016, of which 90% will conduct online banking. So what does that mean for Malaysia? Essentially, the growth in digital banking, you'll see 62% mobile banking growth. So we're saying that by 2016, 21 million people will be banking online in Malaysia, right? And we're a population of 30 million, so that's two-thirds. So every Malaysian bank is jumping into the bandwagon. And so Malaysian banks realize that we don't sound very sexy to the Gen Y, to the digital or tech-savvy people. So all Malaysian banks have come up with sub-brands. So that's the first approach I'm seeing with regards, not just in Malaysia, but generally worldwide. Most financial institutions have adopted sub-brands in their online acquisition and conversion efforts so that people will see us a little bit differently. You're not this old, traditional, big, boring bank. You're young, funky, new. And for us, Hong Leong, we've adopted a sub-brand called Connect and the other competitors in my market. We also have been pushed to reinvent our delivery channels. We did a survey, and most Gen Y tech-savvy people felt that, you know, we weren't savvy enough to break into this market. And so they were looking at alternative channels. They were using telcos. They were using non-banks. So we came up with a sub-brand, not an online sub-brand, but a completely different segment. So we decided to call ourselves MAC. It's an engineering term for speed. So we launched in 2012. It was supposed to be a whole lifestyle banking customized for Gen Y. It was an interesting experience and experiment for us because we had to put in a couple of things in our products. It wasn't just selling a car loan or a house loan. We actually had to put in lifestyle products. We had to put in a whole new customer experience into our offering. And so we started to reinvent our branches. So our branches look cooler, we use tablets, we're working towards now video online, which is I think in some markets already doing that. But the whole idea is to give a new custom experience to consumers. And the idea of building this brand, which we're seeing in some parts of the world, is to detach the new digital banking solutions from the mother bank. So the collaboration, I feel, so where we're moving forwards is, oh, sorry, and the other thing was, of course, after we did the whole branch thing, we launched a killer product. We had to go out to the market and say, we're new, and this killer product is, we've termed it PEX. We hope and we aspire to be like Kakao, so that one day people would verbalize PEX in our market. Essentially, what it allows is for people to pay someone else just using a mobile number. You don't have to be a bank. You don't have to have a bank account with Hong Leong. You don't have to tell us your account details. We just PEX over the money into to your mobile number, and you can decide how you want to take the money. So we have two ways. You can actually go to our ATM machine without a card. You get a PIN number, and you can key in your PIN number and withdraw money from the ATM. Or you could drop it online into your preferred bank account. So it could be a completely different bank. And that's taken our market by storm. So to us, may not sound terribly sexy to those of you who've, you know, built things that can take you to the moon, but for us it was rather revolutionary, I would say. So sub-branding was important to us, changing the face of our branches was important to us, and providing new products, digital products, is critical to us. What is important to us is the entire road towards digital transformation for the entire financial industry, and I'm not just talking about my bank. Globally, there has to be greater collaborative efforts, and I feel this is extremely critical. I call upon the use digital creatives, telcos, e-commerce providers to actually work with banks, because the whole financial system, money still sits largely within the financial system. While small money is being moved around, there's a lot more you can do than just payments. So the banks still provide financing. So the financing piece hasn't quite come through the e-commerce channels, which we hope to use, so that one day you could literally just buy a house loan completely online and you don't have to come to see us. You want to buy something through, you know, JD.com, which is a huge purchase, which you probably need to borrow money from, and which you would then want to work through the financial markets to try to raise money. So from retail to even wholesale moving forth. And what we're seeing, what we're working in our markets, we believe also that it's going to be mobile will largely drive retail, but there is still the wholesale market, which is largely untapped at this point in time. And when you talk about B2B at this point in time, it's still small amounts. And so we want to look at bigger tickets, probably even tapping into the capital markets through the e-commerce, which you need to use the banks. So for us, it is a whole transformative effort. And as if I may say, for us, the journey has really only begun for the banks. We're probably five, I don't know. My guys keep telling me that we're really dinosaurs in this whole space. We're 15 years behind everybody. I would like to think that, you know, most of us have already evolved, and that hopefully, you know, in years to come, we will see greater integration between the financial system and the electronic space, the digital space. Thank you.